Hello everyone, this is Mohan Kumar, Assistant Professor in Zoology, Maharani Science College for Women. Today I shall be talking about active transportation across plasma membrane. Active transport is called active because this type of transport requires energy to move molecules, and energy we get through ATPs. ATP is the most common source of energy for active transports. Here is a picture where ATP cycling is shown. ATP loses a phosphate molecule, releasing energy to become ADP. ADP again gains on phosphate molecules through energy absorption and forms ATP. It is a cyclical phenomenon. So if a substance must move into the cell against its concentration gradient, that is, if the concentration of the substance inside the cell must be greater than its concentration in the extracellular fluid, the cell must use energy to move the substance. As molecules are moving against their concentration gradient, active transports cannot occur without assistance. So it has to have some assistance. So typically proteins or carriers, protein molecules, which are channels, would come in the aid of assistance. Now active transport uses specific transport protein, something called as pumps, which use metabolic energy to move ions or molecules against their concentration gradient. There are different types of pumps for the different types of ions or molecules, such as calcium pump, proton pump, sodium pump, etc. So we have listed out four classes of pumps. So substances that are transported across the cell membrane by primary active transport include metal ions like sodium, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and so on. Now these charged particles require ion pumps or ion channels, as I said earlier, to cross membranes and distribute through the body. So based on the transport mechanism as well as genetic and structural homology, there are considered to be around four classes of ATP driven ion pumps. Now what are they? P class pumps, example include sodium potassium pumps and calcium pump. V class pump, plasma membrane of osteoclast has such pumps. F class proton pumps, inner mitochondrial membrane pumps. ABC superfamily, example is flipase. Flipase I already discussed, where a phospholipase would be, where a phospholipid would be flipped from inner leaflet to outer leaflet or outer leaflet to inner leaflet. That is also a type of pump belonging to ABC superfamily. Now coming to the other types, the P, F and V classes only transport ions, while the ABC, as I said, only transport small molecules. The sodium potassium pump is one of the large class of P-type ATPs, so-called because they all incorporate a phosphate-linked intermediate in their mechanism. So phosphate linked intermediate, if it is kept in the mechanism, then it is P class pump. Whereas F class and V class pumps, both are structurally similar to one another but not related to P class pumps. All known F and V class pumps transport only protons. So V class pumps maintain low pH at the cost of ATP, whereas F class pumps function at power of the synthesis of ATP. So I shall discuss about F-class proton pump today along with P-class pumps for our syllabus. Sodium potassium ATPase, or simply called sodium pump. So in mammalian cells, the sodium and potassium gradients are the two major components of the electrochemical gradient across the plasma membrane. So the cells maintain a lower intracellular sodium concentration and a higher intracellular potassium concentration with relative to the extracellular space. Hence, for the generation and maintenance of the electrochemical gradients for sodium and potassium, it requires sodium-potassium pump, or ATPase molecule, which is an ion pump that couples ATP hydrolysis to cation transport. So, in an osmotic and ionic balance in the cell, potassium ions are at a ratio of 35 inside to 1 outside. Whereas sodium ions, if you look at it, 0.08 inside to 1 outside. So, the ratios are skewed. Thus, it becomes imperative for the cell to efflux excess sodium from inside the cell while uptaking potassium ions. So sodium potassium ATPase is also called a pump because it pumps 3 sodiums out and 2 potassium inward in both direction across the membrane in presence of hydrolysis of ATP. This would happen. So how does this happen? Let's see the mechanism. So this is from looking at the process starting from the interior of the cell, that is, you are placed inside the cell and now you are studying this. So the pump has a higher affinity for sodium ions than potassium ions. Thus, after binding, ATP binds 3 intracellular sodium ions. See, if you look at this picture here, there are 3 sodium ions which are bound and an ATP is bound. ATP hydrolysis is actually releasing the 3 sodium outward and simultaneously picking 2 potassium inward through a conformational change. This conformational change in this position to this position would have released the sodium outward and increasing the affinity for potassium. So potassium binds when the conformation has changed, and because of the electrochemical gradient, the potassium is pushed towards inside. So potassium is released inside. This is a simple mechanism. So what we see, and we see this because of an ATP dephosphorylation releasing a phosphate ion, inorganic phosphate ion, and energy. So this energy is the one which is actually pushing, they are bringing the conformational change in the sodium potassium pump, thus releasing the sodium outward and uptaking the potassium and then releasing inward. So this is about sodium potassium pump. Now, what functions does it play? If you look at it, the sodium potassium pump ATPase maintains osmotic equilibrium. So osmotic equilibrium is a point at which the osmotic pressure of the solutions on each side of the membrane becomes equal. That is, at this point, the net transfer of water molecules across the membrane is zero. The water does not move inside or outside. It is balanced. The second is voltage difference across the membrane. It maintains the voltage differences across the membrane, thus aiding the conduction of electrical impulses by nerve and muscle cells. And it also a driving force for co-transport or indirect active transport. In this example, because of the gradient disturbance, the sodium is actually taken from inside and put outside, but while reverting back, it is co-transporting the potassium from outside to inside. Whereas sodium transportation has utilized in energy, whereas potassium transportation has not utilized any energy. It is just a conformational change. And the second pump we gonna discuss today is calcium pump or calcium ATPase. Whereas eukaryotic cells maintain a low concentration of free calcium in the cytosol, around 10 to the power minus 7 molar, whereas the extracellular concentration is very high on the opposite face, around 10 to the power minus 3 molar. So henceforth, a small influx of calcium significantly increases the concentration of free calcium in the cytosol, and the flow of calcium down its steep concentration gradient in response to extracellular signal is one of the means of transporting these signals rapidly across the plasma membrane. Hence, cells maintain a steep calcium gradient across the plasma membrane. If you look at this picture here, there are various ion channels or protein, integrated proteins, which would transport calcium inward. That is, bringing the calcium from extracellular space to the intracellular cytoplasm. VGCC voltage gated calcium channel, NMDA receptors, AMPA receptors, kinase receptors, GPCRs, that is G protein coupled receptors, all these, and even NCX would bring in the calcium from outside to inside when there is a depolarization. Now this calcium level should be regulated inside the cells. There are mechanisms to buffer the calcium, like calcium buffering proteins like calmodulin also exist, or even endoplasmic reticulum would regulate the calcium level by uptaking the calcium. Even mitochondria does the same. In case the calcium levels are higher also, even the PMCA present on the plasma membrane would try to efflux the calcium utilizing an ATP. So plasma membrane, calcium, ATPase, PMCA. It is mediated through calcium extrusion mechanism. So the calcium ATPase is commonly found in muscle cells and neurons. The skeletal muscles have specialized structures of large intracellular calcium stores called as sarcoplasmic reticulum. So that is why they are called as sarcopumps or sarco, which regulates calcium uptake and release throughout the cell volume. So these are mainly responsible for calcium extrusion from cytosol in muscle cells and also neurons, which is required to stop muscle contraction and to initiate relaxation. Calcium transporters are also common examples of P-type transport ATPase. It is known as calcium pump or calcium ATPase or sarcopump. These transporters actively pump out calcium from the cell and helps in maintaining the gradient. Now, how does it do it? If you look at the mechanism of the calcium ATPase in the SR membrane, that is sarcoplasmic reticulum membrane, can be understood clearly through this picture. So the protein in E1, this part, the protein in E1 configuration has two high affinity binding sites for calcium ions, which is accessible from cytosolic site, as you can see here, and ATP binds to a site on cytosolic surface. In the presence of magnesium, the bound form of ATP is hydrolyzed to ADP here, and a phosphate is released. Later, the liberated phosphate is transferred to a specific aspartate, it's an amino acid residue in the protein, forming a high energy acyl phosphate bond denoted by E1P. So then the protein undergoes a conformational change and generates E2, this part, which has two low affinity calcium binding sites accessible to the SR lumen. The free energy of E1P is greater than E2P, and this reduction in free energy leads to E1 to E2. So there is a conformational change from E1 to E2. So simultaneously, the calcium ions also dissociate. When E1 to E2 conformation is seen, E2 releases the calcium ions outwardly, that is into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, that is endoplasmic reticulum. So dephosphorylation then again leads to E2 to E1, so conformational change. So E1 is again ready for transport of two more calcium ions. So E1 to E2 is a conformational change upon binding and dephosphorylation, that is ATP losing a phosphate group and the phosphate groups attaching itself to an aspartate amino acid residue in the E1 conformation, thus changing the E1 to E2 and E2 releasing the calcium again, and E2 again gets back to E1 by phosphorylating ADP to ATP. So this is how a calcium pump would work. Lastly, we have proton pump. As I said, this we are talking about the proton pump of F class, where inner mitochondrial membrane pump, I shall be giving you as an example for proton pump. So this is an integral membrane protein pump that builds up a proton gradient across a biological membrane, and proton pumps catalyze the following reaction, where H plus on one side of the biological membrane plus energy is ATP, where releasing the H plus on the other side. That's why using the energy of the conformational change or ATP can push the proton from inside to outside. As you can see on the electron transport cycle, complex 1, complex 2, complex 3, complex 4 are there, either based on the Q0 movement on the Q cycle, the protons are moved from one direction to another direction, I mean one side to another side across the membrane. So leaving the complex 2, complex 1 and complex 3 and complex 4 plays a vital role in shifting the protons from the inside to the outside, thus creating a proton motive force. So this is about all the three pumps of the active transport mechanisms on a plasma membrane. If you have any doubt, you can reach me on my personal WhatsApp number, or you can leave a comment below. Thank you.